Good day. What a wonderful privilege to just enter into God's presence again through His grace and His mercy. The title of this morning is, When is the right time to accept Jesus Christ? We've got all these excuses. I'll wait till I'm ready. I'll wait till I have sorted my life out, as if we can sort it out on our own. I'll wait till I'm older. Well, let's just look into a few things. But let us pray first. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. We honor you for who you are. And this morning we call on you, our Holy Spirit, to just come and teach us. Father, we thank you that we can ask of you for discernment and wisdom. And we honor and praise you. And as always, we vow to give you and you alone the glory. Amen. There's a true saying that timing is everything. And many people have missed even their callings through timing, the wrong timing. Now, we all know about Kronos and Kairos time. The ancient Greeks had two words for time, Kronos and Kairos. The former, namely Kronos, refers to the chronological or sequential time, while the latter signifies a proper or opportune time for action. While Kronos is quantitative, Kairos has a qualitative or a permanent nature. Kairos is an ancient Greek word meaning the right, critical or opportune moment and signifies a proper or opportune time for action. It was that moment when the speaker paused to allow his audience to make a decision and act upon it. The word Kairos has its root in archery, of all things, where it denoted a penetrable opening or an aperture through which the Greek archers aimed, simulating the forest of shields and armor coming their way. And there was that small gap in that armor where they had to put an arrow through. The arrow had to pass through there to reach its target. Now, they also used to put a round ring on the top of a wall, protruding from the wall. If this was the wall, then you had the ring there. And then they would come on horseback, and they will start firing arrows. And then they will come and they will fire an arrow to go through that ring. Now, to go through that ring, they had to compensate for the movement of the horse, the correct power which they used to pull back on the string. Everything had to be perfect, and that had to be a Kairos moment. So you understand that Kairos speaks of perfection, a moment in time that cannot, if you pass that moment, it's gone. You had to do it. You had to grab the moment. Now, what does scripture say? Isaiah 55 verse 6 says, seek, inquire for, and require the Lord while he may be found, claiming him by necessity and by right. Call upon him while he is near. Hebrews 3 verse 15 says, then when it is still called today, if you would hear his voice, and when you hear it, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion in the desert, when the people provoked and irritated and embittered God against them. Have you noticed that the emphasis here is on now, today, a specific moment in time that asks for you to act right now? There's a blacksmithing saying that is a good example. And we all know this. Strike while the iron is hot. It's all about timing. Do you sense an urgency here yet? One of the biggest problems in our life is called procrastination. It ruins our lives. Yet we lay awake at night because we know that something needs to be done. We lay awake because we know I've put this off so long. And guess what happened? You put it off another time. We keep on putting it off, keep on delaying until such a time that that very thing becomes a problem, it becomes a crisis, or it simply just becomes too late to do anything about it. Now, I will never forget a minister that he was told the story that he was eating in a restaurant. And while eating in the restaurant, he met a young lady and they saw that one of her fingers was amputated. And she was very friendly and she served him. And he had this thing to tell her about Jesus Christ. And it just became, the feeling just became stronger and stronger. And as a minister, he knew that the Holy Spirit was talking to him and prompting him. But he kept quiet. And months later, he stopped at a traffic light. And while he was waiting for this light to turn green, there were Moonies. Now, that's an American group of cult. And the Moonies was busy. And they were distributing some of their pamphlets. And his window was open, it was a hot day, and all of a sudden the hand comes in and gave him a pamphlet as well. And the natural thing for him were to say, I don't want anything to do with this. And he looked up in the face, and he looked at the finger, and he see the amputated limb, and he says, sure. That is the same girl that God prompted me to speak to. The Holy Spirit said to him, I wanted you to introduce her to the sun. The devil introduced her to the moon. I want you to get the desperacy in this man's life, or what he felt afterwards. He says, Lord, I missed it. I had one opportunity. I never went to that restaurant again. I had one opportunity. You called on me because I was your man or the person that you wanted to use there on that spot. Maybe that was the day that lady was spiritually prepared and ready. Maybe the next person that walked in there was the Moonie that showed the wrong way. And so it is so important that a well-known American minister also ministered that a mother asked him to speak to a son that was totally into the world. And he went and he spoke to him and also met him at the diner, restaurants, almost like our Wimpy franchise here. And he sat there with him and he pleaded with him, and this man just looked at him. When is the right time? I'll wait. I'm still too young. I've still got stuff to do. And he walked out there and he even had his little plastic sandwich bin with him because he was on his way to work. He met him very early before work for an early breakfast. And while the minister was paying their bill, there was a terrible sound outside of screeching of tires, and a big black 18-wheeler truck collided with this young boy. And all the minister saw was his little food bin lying on the floor, on the ground there. And he looked up. And this, on the big black vehicle was this chrome bumper, massive bumper, with a sticker on it, Hell's Angel. And he says it was almost like he said, this young man had one chance. There was a Kairos moment for him, but he rejected it. And he lost it all. You know that I like to use stories to illustrate something. I want to tell you another story this morning just to show you about timing, how we cannot afford to procrastinate. There was this king, a very wealthy king, not a bad man, and he wanted a picture of himself sitting with his whole cabinet and his leaders and his generals. Now you must understand that is before the invention of cameras, so there wasn't the Kodak moment. And he sends his advisors out in the country to search for the best artist. And after a while, they return and say, sir, we have found a right man. There's an artist here. He is just the best. You should see his work. We studied his work, and it is so lifelike. His attention to detail is amazing. It looks really real. So the king met with the painter and discussed what he wanted him to do. And then the king said to him, you know, I'm a very busy man. We must decide when you will paint me. But this is what I want you to do. And the painter said, and there's a matter of urgency. He says, oh, sir, shouldn't we start with you? And he says, but you don't understand, I'm a busy man. And the painter gave in and he says, all right, sir, what we will do is I will start painting the throne room first. Then I will start with all your people in the order of their importance. I will start with all of them. And I will always leave a gap. And then right at the moment, I will ask you to come and we will paint you into this beautiful picture. And for weeks and weeks, this artist toiled over this canvas. Every day he had someone else to come and sit and he did that part of the painting. And every evening the king would go and have a peek at the canvas. And every evening the artist will say, "Don't you want to be next, O king? Don't you think it is? We should do it." And every time the king says, "I'm so busy," and the artist says, "It's okay, sir. It's all right. You can wait till last." After weeks, the artist reported that the king's chances come. "Sir, tomorrow morning, first thing, we start on you. Everything and everyone else has now been painted. This beautiful painting was just waiting for the king to be added." The next morning, very early, the king dressed in his most beautiful royal robes and he waited in the throne room and he paced up and down and he went to sit and practice his pose for when the artist will come, but no artist put in an appearance. Eventually, his advisors come and say, "Sir, we've got bad news. Our artist died during the night." And the king was devastated, but so was the memory for the artist. The king put off and the artist allowed it, and he also put off. And that's this painting that would have been the crowning glory, if you can put it like that, of his life's work. I mean, not everyone gets to paint the king. That beautiful painting, all the other things on that canvas was perfect, but it lacked the picture of the king. It was all about the king. It was supposed to be all about the king. The king missed his opportunity, but also by procrastinating, the artist also lost his opportunity to have been able to put on his CV, even if it was posthumous, to say that artist painted the king. His masterwork, his best ever. Everybody has spoke of one thing. Not the intricate detail of that which was on the canvas, but the absence of the king. I want to encourage you this day to get the king in your life first. If you could sort out your life, let us deal with that excuse. It wasn't necessary for Jesus Christ to go and die on Golgotha's hill. If we could do it ourselves, we wouldn't have need of Jesus Christ. But we couldn't. That is why he paid the price. Otherwise, there will always be a vacant spot in the canvas of your light where the king should have been. Matthew 6 verse 33 says, "But seek him, aim at and strive after first of all his kingdom and his righteousness, his way of doing and being right. And then all these things taken together will be given you besides." The correct time to, or the right time to accept Jesus Christ is now. Get him on the canvas of your life and the rest will fall into place. May I ask that should your life end today, and I'm not praying this over anyone, but will the story of your life be complete? Will the king be the one that when they look at your life says, "The king was in his life. The king was a part of it all along." Heavenly Father, when we come before you this day, we really want to look into the mirror of your word. And we need to look and ask ourselves whether the king is in our life. Whether the king is on the canvas of our life story. Whether the king's name will be read on every page of our life story. This very moment I ask that through and by your Holy Spirit, you will show people, you will give them an urgency, you will make them cry out to you and say, "Lord, be my portion." Father, I want Jesus Christ to be the Lord of my life. I won't get off of my knees. I won't say amen now, Lord, until you have entered my life. If it is sin that I need to repent of, Lord, I want to repent right now. But Lord, I need you. I need you in my life. Every second, every breath that I take. Father, I honor you for this opportunity. And I pray that every single one, when they go to bed tonight, will say, I can sleep. Because the King is on the canvas of my life. In Jesus Christ's wonderful name. Amen. This old song that quotes the scripture that we read in Matthew. And it said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Do it today. Last Sunday, Pastor Bert Fiedler ended here with us by saying, wise men still seek him. God bless you.